So this series is about this general topic of sustained good life, sustainable good life, not just good life, but sustainable good life, and technology, what role technology plays and can play in a life that is good. And that's something that I'll explore in this first lecture. What is good life? For not just me, you, people who are privileged in some sense, but for the whole world. And what is sustainable good life that can be sustained from generation to generation. Now technology, which is the focus also, what role does technology play in producing good life? Technology is developed for a number of reasons. One of the most important reasons for technology has been warfare. You can see from 1,000 years or more, being able to wage warfare is an important motivator for technology. Fear, desire to overpower. Even now, some of the best technologies developed for the Defense Department, for developing radar systems, guidance systems, missile chasing systems, all those things are part of technology. And we have to acknowledge they have repercussions on both good and bad life. Technology is also developed, and it's a very important role, for scarcity if you don't have something. Like, we are very comfortable in this room, even though outside it's so bitter cold. Right? So we are in an arbor, and we can comfortably gather here and enjoy this afternoon. So technology is used for scarcity. If it's hot, you can cool yourself. If you're hungry, you can feed yourself. And also survival. So our survival does depend on technology. Then economics, for jobs, for opportunities. Technology is there. Also for search of truth. Understanding the physics, laws of physics, chemistry, biology. There's a lot of search, which is very exciting. Technology is part of that. And also for fun. Technology is fun. Video games, gaming, all that is fun. But in this talk and this series, we'll focus on technology from the point of view of the good life. And so that's the main theme. So even though all these other measures are very important, and certainly they have advanced technology and will continue advancing technology, it's important to look at technology from the point of view of good life. And for that, we need to understand first, of course, get an idea of what is good life and what is sustainable good life. So if we look at stories we've heard from childhood, some of the stories that are most exciting are where we can do anything we want. Right? So from the Arabian Nights, the genie, that we just rub and, you know, the genie appears and says, what do you want? And you get it. Right? Or we are also fascinated by stories like the King Midas, who had the Midas touch. And anything he touched turned into gold, which is all very exciting, but till he touched his daughter. Right? And so technology has been, this is a technology, it's a dream technology. Right? So these Arabian Nights stories, the stories from mythologies, they also talk about technology, even if that technology was not present. So it's always fascinated. And in some sense, technology where it is almost magical. You can take out a smartphone, and you can call anybody anywhere in the world. And doesn't matter, you can call from a village in Africa or a village in India. You can call any person. You can browse the internet. You can ask any question you want and get an answer from Wikipedia or Google. So technology has become almost magical. However, how much does technology contribute to the good life? And why is it so hard to get the good life? So even though we have technology, and this is the age of knowledge, especially in developed countries, especially in universities like this, in cities like Ann Arbor, we have so much knowledge. We have so much knowledge. And technology has contributed to that knowledge. I can ask almost any question. If it has an answer somewhere, it's on the internet. Right? I can find that answer. So technology is pervasive. But why is it so hard to get the good life? And how does technology help us get the good life? So those are the questions we want to ask and explore in this series, which are 6 of them. And this is the first one. So this one will focus more on the general idea of good life and understanding good life. And this idea is becoming more and more important for a number of reasons. If we had infinite resources, we could go anywhere we want. And if we have a misstep, if we suffer, if something goes wrong, we can always correct it because we have enough resources. If we don't have enough resources or our resources are getting limited, then we have to be a little more careful and mindful of understanding, after all, we live for good life, what is good life, and taking paths that are leading us to good life. So there are five triggers, and you have read about these and heard about them from many places, but I'll just summarize them. So the first is our energy needs and our energy resources are, we realize, the resources are limited. Right? Even though, of course, technology contributes a lot to developing new resources, we realize that we can't just abandon the resources we have and just waste them. So energy needs, and represented by this time cover of global warming, issues related with global warming, and issues related with other energy-related issues. So that's an important area, that our energy needs are limited. The second is there's a globalization of economy. And so privileged pockets have been lost. Borders don't protect a style of living. So you can't think, well, I live in the developed countries, I live in US or I live in France, and therefore I should have a certain kind of lifestyle. It's not going to happen because people around the world are competing with us. So people are competing. The economy has become totally global. It's going to continue becoming more and more global. So the question, what is my lifestyle? What is its impact? Is it supportable by the system I'm living in? Becomes more and more important. Third one, everybody wants a good life. So here is a National Geographic picture of untouchables in India. They want and deserve a good life. So we can't say, let's develop a lifestyle which is for some people. So sustainable lifestyle now means that everybody, everywhere wants the good life. Now, what is the good life? That's what we'll explore. But we can't build a lifestyle which is sustainable assuming that 90% of the world will live a certain way and 10% or a few percent will live a different way. Right? So we have to develop lifestyles, and technology can help in that. Next one, the information age and robotics, and more of what we do, what even we think of as this is something that only humans can do. More and more we see that machines are doing them, robots are doing them, and this is just the cusp. Right? So when we look at technology and where it's going, we realize this is just the cusp. There'll be robots cooking dinners, serving food, cleaning everything, robots doing almost everything, entertaining us, talking to us, playing soccer with us. Right? So robots will be pervasive. And how does one address that oncoming onslaught? Just like what PCs have done, the personal computers, the personal tablets, smartphones, as robots come in, what happens? And finally, healthcare. That's a big challenge. Right? So it's how do you live your life so you have minimal impact and on the healthcare, or the resources needed for healthcare. So all these five elements have produced this time where we need to really think what is good life and then work to achieve good life. Right? So have our focus that this is what I want to reach. I want to have a good life. So I start by looking at good life by looking at food. And I come from a family in northern India where my ancestors have been farmers not for 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, but 600 years. Right? So we've had a farm in northern India which has been in our family for 600 years. It's a small farm. And so I start with food because food is a perfect metaphor for good life. What makes a good meal? What makes a good food? What makes a sustainable meal? Because sustainable food also sustains the earth, sustains the environment. So I'm going to start with food. And for that, I'm going to take a little moment here and pick up this thing that you may have seen me bringing in. But I'll put it somewhere here so I can show it to you. And this is my good life. So here is the good life. Right? So I'm going to show you what good life is. And you can actually carry it with you. It's the good life is something that should be just part of you. Right? So I'm going to show you the good life in a moment here. So what is food? Food should have many different components. just like good life should have many different components. So food should not be just proteins, just steaks and meat, and that should be part of food, right? Protein, which builds our muscles, energizes us. Protein should be there. Carbohydrates should be there, which come from grains, from nuts, from fruits, as well as vegetables. Then you have to have some fuel, maybe some butter, some ghee, which is clarified butter, which is fantastic if you cook with it. Then there should be some herbs, some spices. There should be some turmeric, which is really good for your brain. If you don't know that, you should know that. There should be some cardamom, cinnamon. There should be some tea, if you like, some wine, if you like, some chocolate, and good friends. Right? So that's all part of good life. So let's look at this. And so I'm going to pull out from this some of the elements of food. So here is milk, right? So here's milk. Here's some salad, some greens. But then I have some of the building blocks. I have some rice, right? Some really good basmati rice. And then I have some, these are black chickpeas, full of protein, just fantastic. Then I have some lentils here. And then I have some, an apple, some vegetables. But then going to finer points, and also I have some cashews, some peanuts, some nuts. And of course, I didn't bring any meat because it might spoil, but you can have that as well. Then going to finer things, I have an onion. So food, in addition to simply providing us nourishment, right, the basic pyramid should go beyond that. Right? The basic pyramid, okay, you have this mixture of protein, this mixture of carbs, fat, this, that. But food should go much beyond that. Food should also have elements that cleanse you. Right? So I have some garlic here, which is a great cleanser of the blood. It helps. I have some ginger here. So food should have these elements also. And going further, I have some cloves, some cardamom, some cinnamon. I have turmeric. If you haven't seen, I don't want to take it out because it colors you. You touch it and your finger is yellow for the next 1 week. Right? Very, very powerful for the brain health. Right? So when you look at food, and I have some chocolates here. Right? So food has many elements, and good life should have equally great number of elements. It shouldn't be just one thing. That's very important. This kind of food is sustainable. It can sustain my body. It can sustain a society, a culture. It can also sustain Earth. If you mix all these things. And finally, very important, food should also include this. Right? So a toothbrush, a floss, a toothpaste, right? So all of this makes up food. If I don't have this, I can enjoy all the food. Then my teeth will rot, fall out, I'll be in pain. So all of these elements should be there in a good meal. Right? So with that, and I'll build a similar kind of good life scenario for actual good life. Right? So food is a great metaphor to look at good life. This is my village. Of course, I don't live there. I live here. But this farm has been with our family for 600 years. It's at the border of India and Pakistan. And this is from my mother's side. The farms we had from our father's side were lost in India's partition. So they are in Pakistan, but we still have this one. I grew up in Delhi, but I used to visit. This is my mother and her brother who runs the farm. And this was a while ago. My mother passed away. But you can see a small farm which can produce this kind of food. And these are my cousins who are grinding up the herbs. And I can tell you the food is the most delicious I've ever tasted because it's just pulled out of the ground and served. So when we take these journeys of good life, it's very important to realize, you know, there's a price to make mistakes in good life. So when you look at food, if my food was only cheeseburgers, French fries, and shakes, right? That food in the long run can neither sustain me, and it can't sustain the earth also. So it's important to realize that what sustains me at a small level also sustains the environment on a large level. Right? So that knowledge is there. We all know that. And so if we had infinite resources, you know, if I had $1 million and every time my heart got clogged up, I said, oh, well, I'll just go to U of M hospital, get it cleaned out. That would be fine if I had $1 million, but I don't. Right? And the world certainly does not. Right? So it's very important to take journeys, recognize what are the paths that lead to good health, what are paths that lead to good life, and pursue those paths. And if we can't, let technology help us pursue those paths. So you can see over here, we cannot afford anymore, right? If we had infinite resources, we could eat. I remember when ex-President Clinton was running for office, there would be all these cameras showing him going to this shop and eating cheeseburgers and French fries. And of course, in the end, unfortunately, he was completely clogged up. Now he's converted. You know, he's a spokesman for healthy eating, and that's fantastic. So it's a great role model. But we don't have to go that route. Right? We don't have to actually just do what President Clinton did. We can learn, right? So, and if you don't know this lady, she's been in news, so it's a very recent news. So her show, I used to watch quite often because, you know, once in a while you are flipping channels, you see Paula Deen presenting her cooking, and it's almost like a freak show because you're taking donuts, putting them inside hamburgers, frying the whole thing and eating it, and, you know, it's like, whoa. And of course, now, fortunately, she's realized the errors of her way, and she's a spokesperson for type 2 diabetes, right, which she has. So good life and good eating, of course, is a metaphor. It's very important. So let's examine the importance of good life. Life is a rare event. Right? So the life that we have is so precious. If you think about it, how precious life is. It's such a rare event. Out of billions of planets, stars, moons, Earth, so far, that's as far as we know, Earth sustains life. Out of all the life, human life is so incredible. So if you think about the gift that we have as human beings, that we are alive, we have this life, it's simply incredible. Right? So it makes so much sense to take care of this extremely precious, and no matter what your beliefs, we all realize, scientifically we realize, culturally we realize, human life is so, so precious. Right? So makes so much sense. It's so rare, and it can be lost so easily. It can be lost so easily. Just a simple mistake can ruin your life. Right? So having care, taking care of good life is very, very important. Nature has created a world for us which is very time asymmetric. You can spend years building up a fine physique. Within a second, you can lose it. So time is very asymmetric as far as good life is concerned. You can build a relationship with somebody for years and years. In minutes, you can destroy it. And we see that all the time. So it's so important to be mindful of good life. And our health degrades, diseases overpower, we feel. So good life is not guaranteed. Healthy life is not guaranteed. It needs care, it needs mindfulness. So before I continue, I'm going to take you through a mindful exercise, and I'm going to take you through a breathing exercise. Right? So we'll take a minute, and I'll teach you, if nothing else, I'll teach you how to breathe. So stay as you are. Don't start shifting. Stay as you are. Because see, already that started shifting how you were sitting. So I'm going to take you through a yogic breath. And there are hundreds of styles of breathing in yoga. Because in yoga, the breath is used to develop mindfulness. So I'm going to teach you one style of breath. So in this yogic breath, which first I'll just take a minute to teach you, when you inhale, try to inhale through your diaphragm by pressing your diaphragm out. So you are inhaling for, say, about 5-6 seconds. Then you hold for a couple of seconds. Then you exhale for 5-6 seconds and hold for a couple of seconds. So the breath is about 16 seconds or 15, 16 seconds. Normally, we breathe about 5 seconds a breath. Right? So we'll do that. So let's prepare. So I'll raise my hand. So you inhale. So let's inhale. Exhale. Inhale. Exhale. Okay, that's it. So now what I want you to do is the following. If you feel comfortable, I'll lead you through three or four breaths of this same style. So you know how to breathe. It's very simple. In the first breath, adjust your posture. So you're sitting a certain way. Adjust your posture in the first breath by looking inwards, seeing yourself from your toes, the tip of your fingers. Can I sit in a more comfortable, alert way? So let's do one breath where you're just going to do that. So let's inhale. Very good. So you're sitting a lot more alert. You look a lot nicer. Of course, you always look great, but you're looking more alert, and your spine is suffering less, your shoulders are suffering less, your neck is suffering less, just in one breath. So next breath, I'll ask you to do one more thing, and I'll keep asking you, so I'll keep bugging you to participate in this, so bear with me. So in the next breath, if you're comfortable, I would like you to take the breath with your eyes closed and release any worries, anxieties, deadlines you may have in your mind. Release. That's, I know in this department, it's really hard to do. It's really hard to do, but try that. So just like you're not sitting with your backpacks, right? So you may have backpacks, you may have briefcases, you left them, right? Just like that, just release your worries, anxieties, deadlines. So let's take one slow breath with your eyes closed if you're comfortable. And open your eyes. We'll do one more breath. And in this breath, recognize how precious your life is and how important it is to take care of your own life. So let's do one more breath with the eyes closed. And open your eyes. Great. So I'm going to continue. So let's look at what good life is. So good life, here's a picture of good life, and I think this is a fantastic life, right? If I could live like that, I would live like that. It's a fantastic life. It's not sustainable, unfortunately, but this good life is based on sensual pleasures. And I personally believe, and I think all of us agree, this is an important part of good life, right? So we can't ignore people who live this kind of life. So girls who love to wear their chihuahuas and diamonds and, you know, why not? Why not, right? So that's fantastic. That's a great life. And if somebody like Paris Hilton wants to do that, I say, fantastic, you know, more power. If we just eat caviar and French bread and all day, that's all we eat, that's also good life, right? It may not be sustainable and your stomach may not, you know, agree with you after a while, but that's part of good life. Having a yacht, right? Having fine wines. This is a gold Bugatti, right? So really impressive. Not just any other old Bugatti, you know, gold. A beach house, vacations, beautiful diamonds, you know, all that's also part of good life. Can't ignore that. We want sensual pleasures. Maybe not at this extreme, but this has to be included in good life. Then going a little further, there is the other end where Socrates, Buddha, you know, that's also good life. Contemplation. That also has to be part of good life. But one doesn't have to have these extremes. Just like in a good meal, everything should be there. There should be garlic, there should be, if you want some cheese, they should be nuts, they should be greens, they should be fruits. Everything should be there. And so contemplation should be there and sensual pleasure should be there. They all make part of good life. Right? So I'm going to go over seven layers of good life. And there's a very interesting concept described in yoga, which has a fantastic metaphor to describe good life. It doesn't use that concept to describe good life, but what I find is that's a very good way to interpret those metaphors that have been written about, and they're called chakras or rings or rounds. So I'm going to describe to you those seven layers, and I'm going to go over them with you. So this is just a more kind of metaphorical picture, but there are seven elements to good life, and we'll discuss those, and each of these elements is impacted by technology. So So first is physical wellness. Right? So that's the bottom line, physical wellness. If you're not physically well, you don't have a good life. You have to be able to be pain-free. Your body should function. That is part of good life. So taking care of yourself physically is part of good life. Creativity. If you're not creative, that's not part of good. That's something very important in life. And creativity could come from anything. And I'll review all these in a moment. So being creative, that's an intrinsic part of a human being, to do something creative. Could be profound, could be very simple. And villagers in small places where they're living on $1 a day, they can be creative and are creative. And you can be creative in this society. You can invent the next smartphone. That's also creativity. Then balance and multidimensional role in life, functioning at many levels, right? Having social, intellectual, spiritual interactions, so balance in life. That's also having many dimensions to yourself, not just one dimension. That's part of good life. Having connections to others, that's also part of good life. Right? So having love, connections, feeling empathy, being connected to others, feeling part of a social group, that's part of good life. Next, expressing yourself, the harmony between thought and action. That's extremely important. If you're thinking something and you're suppressed, you can't express it, that's a missing link in your good life, being able to express yourself. Freedom of expression, that's part of good life. Self-reflection, being able to know who am I, you know, what is my special, or rather than just running with the herd, knowing yourself, your uniqueness, your special abilities. And finally, spirituality, feeling part of the universe. So all seven of these are part of good life. And just like the ingredients of a perfect meal, a good meal, sustainable meal, all seven should be there every day in our life. And so that's the interpretation. And of course, that's my view. And you can, of course, develop your own views. But all seven should be there. And I'm going to just quickly go over them. So first is physical wellness. And here are some star athletes. Here's Pelé, Bolt. And this is Yelena, who's one of the top pole vaulters. So that represents physical strength, physical wellness, which includes good nutrition, access to clean air, water. That's our right. If you don't have access to clean air, water, it's very difficult to have good life. So physical wellness, things that help me stay physically well. So I'm not in pain, I'm not hurt, I'm not just racked with disease, illnesses, safe shelter, exercise to strengthen the body, and in general, having pain-free living. So have access to healthcare in case something goes wrong. So that's the first level of a good life. And of course, technology makes a big impact. These days, if you go to a hospital, it almost seems like electrical engineering department, right? If you go to an ICU, they have more equipment and sensors and all kind of things than I think this building has. This is the electrical engineering computer science building. If you go to the ICU in U of M hospital, they have far more stuff, right, than we have. Of course, it came maybe at some point from here, you know, developed through students here and elsewhere. But it's amazing how technology impacts healthcare. But of course, the ideal life is you don't go to the ICU. That would be even better. So second layer is creativity. Doing something creative every day in your life. Every day. And if you look at things like, if you look at technology like Apple, it's amazing how much it's allowed us to be creative. Right? So the fact that even this slideshow I can put together, Apple and other such technologies have really unleashed a lot of people's creativity. People can produce all kinds of things, develop some new images, styles, all kinds of things. But creativity can be anything. Children playing. Children, of course, are naturally creative. They have such a desire to play. And you have to kind of work against their natural desire. But we should play also. Right? We should create also. So. Creating just, here's a girl with a beautiful design on her hand, right? This in Indian weddings, this is very often done. This is just a henna design. It's not actually a tattoo, so it can come off. Music. So creativity is, and everybody can create. It doesn't require that you be a top artist, like I'm going to show you. So you don't have to be Bob Marley to create. You can create anything, anywhere, as long as you apply yourselves. You can create, right? That's part of good life. Of course, these people are gifted creators, but you don't have to be a gifted creator. I can just draw a painting, express my creativity. Right? I can grow some vegetables here, like these children just grew some carrots, I guess, and they feel they created something, and obviously gardening. So you don't have to be these superstars. There's a potter, a village potter, and she's creating something beautiful. And so creativity is a part of good life, and everybody, every day, just like every day you should have some greens, some fruit, some every day, everybody should create. Right? So that's part of good life. And it's sustainable. It doesn't cost anything. Right? So if you take half an hour out of your day and you create something, you even could be like a recipe you create. Right? You create a food, create a garden. So creativity is part of good life. Then third, harmony and balance. Being balanced in your life. Right? Not having an imbalanced life. Not a one-dimensional life. Having balance in your life. And these ladies in Nepal are tree huggers. You know, they create balance between themselves and the environment. So balance in personal consumption, neither overeating nor undereating, balance in consumption, balance in social and intellectual interactions. This is Rachel Carson. You know, you may have heard of Silent Scream. Balance in intellectual, spiritual, balance in humanity and environment. And this child running, and I remember as a child doing this, it's like the most exciting thing, right? Running with a wheel, with a stick, right? It's so exciting. It's both creative. Also, you're creating balance. You're balancing this thing as you're going along. And these two of our teachers, you know, I teach yoga, these two are teachers. And next one is, this is one of our other teachers, Tawny. I can't do that, but she can do it. So having balance in your mind and body, mind and spirit, personal, social, the balance is an important part of good life. And every day taking a moment or two and saying, you know, is my life balanced? That's part of good life. Fourth is connection with others, having connection with other people, right? So empathy to others, social connection, also responsibility. Responsibility is a fantastic way to enhance your life. Taking a responsibility and fulfilling responsibilities towards others. So not just demanding, but also responsibility. Love and being loved. It's fantastic. It doesn't cost anything. Right? Some of the sensual aspects of good life are expensive. Some of these aspects of good life are not expensive, and that's why they're sustainable. Right? So it's very important to take care. For example, if I look at this onion, it hardly costs anything. A fine steak may cost a lot. Caviar costs a lot. So we have expensive things in good life and also inexpensive things in good life. And all of them should be there to make good life sustainable. So this doesn't really cost anything. So these girls dancing, they're just using their own energy and having more fun than perhaps getting drunk, I think. So with that, I'm going to have you do an exercise with me. So this is me leading an exercise. It's a good time to take a break. So this is, I was giving a TEDx talk in the ARB this October, and this is laughter yoga. So I'm going to have you do with me laughter yoga. And for that, I'll have you stand up. So take a moment, and if you can, stand up. So yeah, just push your chairs back, make sure you're comfortable, stand up. In this, I'll have you raise your arms as we go up. So we'll inhale like this, and then we'll exhale like this, a little slower. And after we get the breathing pattern, I'll lead you through laughter yoga, and it'll just take like a minute. So let's bring our fingertips together, just touch your thumbs and open your chest. And on the inhale, bring your arms up. So inhale. And exhale. Let's do one more. That's really good coherence. That's yoga. Coherence is yoga. On the next one, when we bring our arms down, just laugh as hard as you can on the exhale, so you can see where it's going to go. So let's inhale. And and let's do it again. It was not loud enough. And once more. And thank you. So have a seat. So you can see, all we consumed was a little bit of nitrogen, oxygen, CO2, some just air. And we produced an event that was a lot of pleasure. Right? So that is the power of connection with others. So that's the fourth layer I described, connection with others. So I'm going to continue with more layers. Expressing yourself. That's a very important part of good life. If your expression is suppressed, you may have a lot of money, you may have even a lot of so-called friends. If you can't express yourself, that is not part of good life. So being able to express yourself, everybody everywhere in the world wants to express themselves. Right? So whether it's Myanmar or Burma or Tunisia, we all want to express ourselves. Right? And technology plays a very powerful role. In all these events that are occurring now, I think all of you have seen what the power of social networks, right, which connect people. The technology producing events where people who never dreamt that actually they can stand up in front of a dictator or somebody controlling them and express themselves. It was unthinkable. And those events are happening. So technology is very, very powerful because expressing yourself, what is in your mind, being able to say it, express yourself in your dress, your customs, your beliefs, it's so powerful, and it's part of good life, and being able to express. And what we just did also was an expression where you laugh, right? So laughter is also an expression. Or expressing yourself, this girl, it's a bride, wearing her jewelry, and she designed this jewelry, she's wearing it, that's also expression. So expressing yourself, part of good life. Then self-awareness, and I mentioned in the beginning, contemplation, right? Self-awareness, knowing yourself, right? So these are just some metaphors for people who understood themselves, whether it's Betty Friedan or Madame Curie or Maharishi and the Beatles and other yogis, rather other people, being able to know who am I and live your life according to that, being able to express yourself. So that's very, very important in good life. And every day we should, all of us, you know, who am I? What's my uniqueness? What makes my life unique? And all of us are unique. Right? So just like our fingerprints, we all have uniqueness. We have common things, but we all are unique. Am I able to express my uniqueness? Do I even know what my uniqueness is? And finally, spirituality. Being able to connect to the universe. Feeling consciousness. Feeling part of being in the universe. Right? So that's also part of good life. And whether it's through religions or faiths, or whether it's through anything. Right? So one doesn't have to belong to a religion to actually be spiritual. You can express spirituality. Do I connect with others? Do I accept? Do I release? Do I see myself in you? Right? So that's spirituality. That's also part of good life. So the higher layers of of the good life actually are not very costly. The lower layers of good life are expensive. The first layer of good life, which is just physical wellness, is pretty expensive. Because you have to take care of yourself. Higher layers are not that expensive, but they require higher level of senses. They require more thinking, more awareness to fully enjoy the higher level of good life. So just going over challenges of good life, because that's in this series, this first I want to just give you an idea of layers of good life. And I think these are empirical. What's interesting also is that a lot of neuroscience work is confirming the benefit, for example, of having friends, the benefits of not suppressing yourself, the downsides of feeling angry, feeling victimized. There's a downside to it. And a lot of studies now, because a lot of medical studies can actually probe the impact of certain feelings, like anger, hate, hate is not a good feeling for your own wellness. So the good life challenges, Earth does not provide us what we want. There's scarcity of food. It's either too hot, too cold. There are diseases, there are wild animals. Then people also are not the best always. There are wars, there are dictators, there are rulers, ruthless people. There are cultural baggages that sometimes don't allow us to liberate ourselves. That also is a hindrance to good life. There are natural laws sometimes we don't understand. Like, you know, a lot of times we still don't understand. Almost 50% of the cancers, we don't understand why they're happening. Right? So that, of course, technology continuously, science and technology works on that. It's very easy to make a mistake and very difficult to correct mistakes. Right? So life is asymmetric. It's very easy to make a mistake, very difficult. If I take this bottle of milk, open it, and by chance it drops from my hand and it falls on the floor. Right? It's very difficult to pull that milk out. It's so easy to drop it, right? So I just momentarily lose my mindfulness, it drops. You know, right now it's the lid is on, but you can easily imagine it happens all the time. It's so easy. This morning when I got up, and I think all of you in Ann Arbor must have seen this, there was a slight glaze of ice. It's so easy to slip, right? So you just step out, you can slip, you can break your hip, and take 2 years to recover. So it's very easy to make a mistake. It takes forever sometimes to undo the mistake. And in the age of knowledge, the more important thing is lack of mindfulness. If you're not mindful, like if I pick up this bottle of milk and I get distracted, I can drop it and it's gone. Right? So this asymmetry in life, where it's easy to make a mistake, hard to correct, we can blame it on this guy. Right? He's Boltzmann. So we can blame it on him, right? Because he told us this thing, that life is asymmetric. He's the kind of one of the founders of thermodynamics. We use him all the time in this department, right? So every course you take, pretty much, you know, from 320 to all these courses, Boltzmann, you know. So Boltzmann is very important. But one of the things is he was among, with other people, one of the founders of thermodynamics, which, and thermodynamics is a science that governs our life, right? So we live in the physical world. Thermodynamics tells us the arrow of time is not symmetric. If you go one way, it doesn't mean you can come back. The arrow of time is not symmetric. So Murphy's law is just thermodynamics. Right? Murphy's law is just thermodynamics. It just states, if it can go wrong, it will. Right? So you have to be really mindful. Otherwise, things will go wrong. And so we have excesses. We have almost nothing. So, you know, to find balance between extremes of excess and nothing, starvation, require technology, require mindfulness. So good life is not a given. It requires care. So the game of life, if you look at it, it's very much like a very complex, highly complex chess game, where moves are coming at you fast and furious. And some of the rules we understand, some we are still trying to figure out. The good thing is that if you make a mistake, you can correct it, but it costs you a lot. So ideally, you don't want to make, once you learn the rules, you don't want to make mistakes, right? Because it's very costly to make mistakes. So there's a strong asymmetry in nature's arrow of time. It's like an insect entering a web, a spider's web, can enter very easily, can't come out. So that is the dilemma we face, that even if you build up good life, mindfulness is needed to maintain your good life. So being so mindful. And technology is a great invention, which, and especially technology as it's coming out now. I'm going to show you a piece of technology. Of course, your smartphone is one of the best technology. It can remind you all the time. You can program it. It can every 2 minutes it can call you, tell you do this. You know, you can have your whole day planned on your technology. So technology is good. But the important thing is this extreme asymmetry in the arrow of time, which reflects itself in many ways, some very, very tragic, like this. How long it took to build this? Decades of engineering, people working for such intense periods of time, and within hours, it was destroyed. Right? So that's how often our life is, that it takes a long time, but you have to be so mindful to protect yourself. Right? So everything can be destroyed in a moment. And you know Congresswoman Gabriella Gifford, The bullet that destroyed her brain, or, you know, hurt her brain, only cost 22 cents. Right? So you can go to a ammunition store, buy a bullet, it only cost 22 cents. Not even a quarter, 22 cents. And to recover from that, it's fortunate, and of course the technology has allowed to recover, because without the healthcare technology we have now, there's no way somebody with that injury would have survived. But it's already cost $1 million. So there's such an asymmetry in life that, you know, it's very expensive to recover. So the best thing is, if you know the rules, try to do your best. So creating the good life and the role of science and technology. So what science does is, of course, gives us the knowledge of the rules of the game. Right? So science provides us a lot of information. Now, through science, we know pretty much a lot of things that can protect our good life. Science also gives us energy. Right? Energy is technology. Energy is, you know, whether you're pumping gas or you're even a lot of our nutrition is coming from technology. It provides us energy to guide and enhance our abilities. It allows us new choices, things that were not there. Like, you could never imagine that, you know, you would just pick up a phone and call somebody in China or India or Africa and just talk to them. And those villagers who have smartphones, I go to my village in India. When I was a child, there was not even electricity. Now I get up in the morning and my uncle is calling Dubai, he's calling Hong Kong, it's, you know, it's looking at wheat prices in all over the world. Right? So it's amazing what choices it gives. It also enhances our senses, and today I'll focus a little bit on senses. It can also allow us mindfulness. It's a great reminder. It can be used, and that's where I think the role of technology really has to be exploited more. It has not been exploited as much. So, focusing on senses and our responses, so our brain, so these days, you know, we can't distinguish technology and humans. We are so interlinked. So we can't imagine, and I remember reading a survey of college students, and they were asked to give up, so the comparison between giving up their laptop and their, say, BlackBerry or smartphone they had, versus giving up their girlfriend or boyfriend. So, and I think you know the answer. The laptop and the smartphone won out by incredibly high margin. Right? So people cannot. So they are. So we are like, our technology has become like our finger or hands. You know, we don't want to give it up. And if the internet is down, like for some reason, you know, the internet's down, we don't know what to do with ourselves, right? We get so frustrated because we can't surf the web. It's become so part of our life. So we have to look at technology as something that is just part of our body, just like our limbs and heart and so on, because that's where it is now. Now, just very quickly, of course, we've gone from the hunter-gatherers to agricultural industrial. Now, all these companies have provided these incredible technologies. And I put somewhere here Walmart. Walmart is a technology company. Right? So if you look at Walmart, what is their model? It's all technology. This technology. Now, technology can do good, bad. Technology is neutral. And what if you want to pursue the good life, you have to use technology very judiciously, just like food. Food has to be eaten. Just because you have a cow doesn't mean you have to kill it and eat it. Right? So technology is something that is there, and how you use it makes sense. So the role of technology in observing, communicating, remembering, deciding, acting, distributing, and then releasing. And I'll focus on release, because that's where technology has not made much of an impact. Right? So technology is amazing in observing, communicating, you know, it's so much more powerful than our brain. But in terms of releasing, and I'll describe that, what we mean in a moment. So of course, you know the basic human senses, and all these senses are enhanced by technology. And over the next series of lectures, I'll talk specifically about technology. This is a more generic kind of talk. So we can hear far better than our ear can, right? So we can hear somebody talking in Beijing. Right? Unimaginable, right? So, but we can hear them very clearly. Better than maybe somebody talking in the next room. We can taste. Now, there are sensors. Of course, a lot of chemical sensors. There are pressure sensors, smell sensors. There are electronic noses that can detect cancer, apparently, and so on. So technology has made a dramatic enhancement in our senses. So when we look at technology, we can see into the heavens, right? So we can see stars, which our eyes can't even imagine they were there. We can hear across the continents. We can see and manipulate atoms. Incredible stuff. We can feel, control the tiniest vibration. We can build almost human-like robots. We can sequence DNA. But can we control our senses and our response? In that regard, technology has not made that much of an impact. And that's an area where technology can make a huge impact, because that is very important when you have the age of knowledge. So knowledge is there, but being able to control ourselves is still not there. So a person today, if you insult a person today, they'll get as angry as a person got angry 1,000 years ago. Right? So if you consider ancient Rome, and you look at a citizen of Rome, and somebody punched him, they get as mad as somebody today who suffered the same. There's no difference. So our response to certain stimuli is the same. It hasn't changed. Even though our knowledge is incredible, like, you know, if you asked a person in Rome, you know, what's the capital of Cameroon or some other, they may not know. But today, just, you know, you can ask a child anything, capital of anywhere. In a few seconds, they'll give you an answer. Right? So knowledge has greatly improved, but our response has not. So in senses, there are other senses. I gave you the five senses. Beyond the five senses, there are other senses, which allow us the other aspects of good life. The five senses are needed for the sensual good life, but there are other senses, and one needs to nurture them. So sense of beauty, sense of play, sense of options, sense of balance. Knowing, if I start eating, knowing that I'm full. Right? That's a huge sense, and often it's not there. Right? Often people don't know that they are full. They're still eating, because that sense is either dormant or not developed enough, almost like not being able to see. Sense of empathy, connection to others, looking at others and knowing what are they feeling. And a highly developed sense, you can look at somebody's face and know what's going through their heart, if you develop that sense. A sense of expression, through art, culture, literature, the importance of these. Sense of self-awareness, being able to see yourself. Right? It's very easy to see others, find fault in others. Very difficult to find something wrong with yourself, because you always think, you know, you don't have that sense. And finally, consciousness. So these are all higher level senses which are needed for higher level. Just like to appreciate garlic, you need a little bit different sense than the sense that is needed to appreciate, say, an apple pie or a dessert. Right? A little bit different sense. They're all important. So our higher level senses are needed to supplement and sometimes override the basic senses. And technology has not played as much of a role. Technology has completely transformed our ability for our normal senses, what we think of as five senses, completely transformed. But our higher level senses, technology is just barely starting to make an impact. And that's where technology has to enhance those senses, if those senses will lead us to the sustainable good life that I was describing. So we need to have higher level senses to have good life with minimal expense. Like we laughed, it didn't cost us anything. Those kind of things need a little bit higher level sense. So sustainable good life requires all seven layers working, just like a good healthy body requires all these elements of food, not just one. So I'll describe a little bit of thermodynamics to you. Thermodynamics is, as I said, one of the sciences that governs our life, more than Newtonian mechanics, right? More than quantum mechanics. Thermodynamics is very, very important because it describes complex systems, and we are complex systems. So in thermodynamics, if you take a journey from point A to point B, any kind of journey, thermodynamics describes two kind of paths you can take. One is a reversible path, where it doesn't cost you anything to take that journey. You don't spend any usable energy. You can go from here to here without spending any usable energy. Those are called universal, reversible paths. No usable energy is lost, no disorder is created. However, to take that journey, you have to stay at equilibrium at all points, which takes forever. So unfortunately, we don't have all the time. And so we take a quick journey, we have to pay a price in energy. So that's what thermodynamics tells us, that if you can reach equilibrium, you can take a journey without paying any price. But if you can't reach equilibrium, you'll have to pay a price. That's a very important rule that comes, and you can look at this. There are equations, there are a series of equations that describe all this. So the equilibration time versus journey time becomes very important. If my journey time is much larger than the equilibration time, if I have all the time in the world, I can take a journey without paying any price. But usually that doesn't happen. Like we are all pressed for time. If the time is other way, there's a cost to the journey. So this is a very important rule from thermodynamics for us. So if we face disturbances in life, right? So if your boss shouts at you, or your partner screams at you, or somebody on the street punches you, or you know, somebody cuts you off on the road, you get upset. You're out of equilibrium. How long does it take you to recover? That time is very, very important for a good life. And we'll explore that more in other lectures. That is the heart of good life. How much time? So imagine for a moment you're on the street and somebody shouts an obscenity at you. How much time does it take you to recover from that? That's the equilibration time. Now there's no technology yet that can quicken that time. So if somebody shouts at you, it may take you several hours, right? And even if you're a very well-balanced, calm person, it takes you several hours to recover from that. If you get upset, you get angry, so you get upset, or you, even if you get really happy, it takes a while to recover from that, right? So somebody says you're the greatest, pins a medal on you, and President Obama this morning came, he selected you personally, and the limelight was on you. It takes a while to recover from that. So whether it's good or bad or upset, it takes time, and that's the equilibration time. Now, what thermodynamics tells us is, in that disturbed state, any journey you will take will cost a lot of energy, or a lot of money, a lot of something. That's an outcome of thermodynamics. So how do you recover very quickly? In science and technology, the thing that makes you recover very quickly, make equilibration very quickly, is catalysts. They're called catalysts. So if you are taking a journey, the catalyst, which is very, very important, catalysts are one of the greatest inventions in technology, because they come more from chemical engineering or chemistry, but they are some of the most important contributions from science and technology, catalysts, making a process go fast, making something happen very quickly, and therefore the cost of the process becoming very, very low. So catalysts, and what technology is needed is catalysts that can bring us into equilibrium state very quickly. So that is, in my mind, one of the greatest contributions technology can make to make us come back to equilibrium after a serious disturbance. So looking at disturbances, there are many kinds of disturbances. So this word disturbance produces stress, and stress is now the number one cause of a lot of health problems. Stress comes in many ways. And if you look at in the US, the drug prescriptions, the highest number of drug prescriptions is for depression, which is a kind of stress. Now, there are some people, of course, chemically, their brain requires medication, but for most of the people, it's not knowing what to do with the disturbance that they're facing in their lives. So vanity, limelight, as I described, excess, deprivation, guilt, anger, sadness, fear, shame, ignorance, all of these are taking you out of equilibrium. And how do we return to equilibrium? Somebody upsets you, get really mad, you can't sleep. Destroys your sleep. It's so easy to destroy something, take one out of equilibrium. And thermodynamics says when you are out of that equilibrium, right, so that's a law, that's one of the outcomes of thermodynamics, what happens when you're in non-equilibrium? How much does it cost? And that's, of course, a huge field of study in thermodynamics. So under these conditions, you will take paths that will cost a lot. Right? So if you're angry, you may punch somebody. So just imagine somebody cut you off on the road. You confronted them, you had an accident. Somebody insulted you, or you felt you were insulted, you punched them. The person called the police, you were in jail. So the kind of reactions we take when we are in stress, out of equilibrium, have tremendous cost. And it may seem like these costs are not much. So what this all means is you're not mindful. You're not connected to the real stuff that is happening. You're not mindful, just like you're out of equilibrium. So what is the cost of mindfulness? or not being mindful. It's a huge cost. So they're quantified. So let's look at some of these. So one, of course, one realized you need higher senses to stay in equilibrium. So these are some Shaolin monks, right? And one of the practices of the monks is under intense stress, stay totally calm. And that's actually the heart of martial arts. Right? So if you study martial arts, if you practice martial arts, one of the most important things in martial art is somebody's coming at you with a knife or a hammer, you're totally calm. Because that's where you need minimal effort to deflect or to protect yourself. And that's the heart of yoga. Right? So in yoga also, you take on very intense, complex, stressful postures, and you learn how can I stay totally calm, even though my body is under so much stress. Right? As well as superstars, like Mr. October, right? So under high stress, he could perform. Right? So superstars know. So the distinction between somebody like Michael Jackson, or he's a superstar, not Michael Jackson, Michael Jordan, for example. Michael Jackson, I would not say he knew how to deal with stress. In fact, it's a counterexample. Right? So he certainly did not know how to deal with stress, and you can see the price he paid. Right? But Michael Jordan, for example, the basketball player, at the last minute, there's only 1 second, and he has the ball, and he still puts it in the basket. Now, if his mind was slightly disturbed, he would not be able to do that. Right? So you know, we all understand the role of calmness in taking journeys, that the best fruit comes when you're totally calm. But how do we get there? What can technology do? So here is a cost of lack of mindfulness, but reflected, not all of it, but reflected partially in this study. So this is from the CDC, the Center of Disease Control. Number of deaths and for leading causes of death. So of course, heart disease, cancer, stroke, chronic respiratory problem. But look at this, accidents. 123,000 Americans die every year for accidents. Almost all accidents are preventable. And accidents occur suddenly, die. And in young people, the number one cause, this is overall, but in young people, the number one cause of death is accidents. Number one cause of injuries, loss of limb is accidents, right? So what is an accident? And accident is usually almost 95% of accidents are lack of mindfulness. Inability to stay in the moment. Right? So if you're working a complex machinery in a factory, for a moment your mind lapses and your hand gets caught and it's crushed. Right? But more importantly, something that is very well documented and very important is car crashes. There are $200 billion of loss in car crashes. And we'll focus a little bit on car crashes because car crashes should not happen. There's no reason for a car to crash. Right? There's almost never that the machinery just fails. There's a small fraction, like you have these unexpected acceleration or all this stuff. Almost all car accidents are preventable through mindful, if you were mindful. So if you look at some of the expenses, car crashes, fire, home fires, car crash, of course, is really big. Drug abuse is more complex, so I won't go there. But car crash is something that is very fixable by technology, because technology is there to prevent pretty much any car crash. So on. So if you look at the cost, almost all these costs are actually lack of mindfulness, getting away from equilibrium. Like thermodynamics says, you get away from equilibrium, pay a price. So there's a science, whole science that tells us about that. So looking at car crashes, there are 6 million car crashes every year. It's mind-boggling. How many car crashes are going on every year? There are almost 40,000 deaths. Right? It fluctuates, so it's sometimes, you know, a little lower sometimes, but almost 40,000 people die. That's more than the people we lost in the last 10 years in the Iraq war. About 5,000, 6,000. Every year. Every day, maybe 100, 110 people die from car crashes. And we somehow have accepted it. But all the technology exists to, in fact, eliminate car crashes, right? Because car crashes should not really happen. it's almost always a lack of mindfulness. so this is just some statistics from this website. So just focusing on this, just continuing with the car crash, it takes 26 gigajoules of energy to produce a car. This is from your NEXCO kind of training manual on sustainability. It takes 26 gigajoules, and there are 5 million cars totaled in the US every year. So each car taking this much. And just to put it in context, in an average country, in US, of course, we consume more, but in countries like India, for example, the average energy consumption per year is about 10 gigajoules per year, 10 gigajoules. So one person can lives in US it's higher, but in some of these countries, one person can live in about half the amount of energy it uses to produce a car. And 5 million cars are destroyed through car crashes. And that's, of course, just relative to the lives lost, it's a small price. It is just metal and you have to reassemble it, but a life lost is far more valuable. Right? So this is just some more information. So when we look at cars, and car is a good metaphor for good life, because certainly if you're in a car crash, that's not good life. Nobody will argue with that being in a car crash is part of leading a good life. It's awful. It's awful. Your car is destroyed. You may hurt yourself. And imagine getting a call that your child was in an accident. It's a horrible thing. It should not happen. Now, first of all, of course, a lot of car can be made safer. Right? So you can have various kind of bumpers and so on. But there is, in fact, today, all the technology that is needed to make a car so safe that it never crashes. It has to be applied. So we have radar systems, we have IR cameras, we have alcohol detectors. Almost a third of the car crashes or deaths arise from people driving drunk. Now, certainly there are alcohol detectors. So this is an area where the technology is there, it has not been applied. There are many places where technology is not there. It has not, so obviously that's a challenge. But this is an area where technology is there. It's not been applied. And the cost is so huge, but culturally somehow we just accept it. We just accept 40,000 Americans will die every year. Right? We just are fine. Right? We get so upset if a foreign country attacks us and maybe kills 3 or 4 of our people. It's so mad. But 40,000 people die, and it's fine, you know. Business as usual, but it should not be. Right? What that requires is people like you, people like the users, the technologists, the engineers, to say, you know, this is unacceptable. And imagine the benefit you'll provide. And of course, we design often technologies. I want a 110 gigahertz radar system. That's all good. But this has a direct benefit on people's lives. So one area where technology has had some success, although I would say still not enough, is home fires. So this is a chart of home fires. And home fires are also lack of mindfulness, almost always lack of, because the home doesn't suddenly combust. Right? It doesn't just burst into flames. Homes go into have a fire because somebody smoked and didn't put the smoke, or something happened, human-related happened. Maybe the wiring was bad. Maybe you did your wiring yourself instead of a licensed electrician. Right? There's something. But technology has still made a huge impact on home fires. So in 77, you can see there were about close to 700,000 house fires. In 2010, there was less than half. Even though the number of people has grown, number of homes has increased more than 50%, the number of fires has decreased by a factor of half. Of course, ideally, this should go like this. It should come down. It should just go to zero. There's no reason for a home fire. But this is a good trend, and the trend is primarily from smoke alarms, as well as other technologies people have installed. So technology is there, because what smoke alarm is doing is making you mindful. Right? So you may be sleeping, so that's a different case. You're not mindful. But even when you are awake, you may not realize, you know, part of the curtain has caught fire. The smoke alarm will tell you. So mindful technologies is really essential to have good life. So that is a challenge for technologists and users. In the age of knowledge that we live in, so we live in the age of knowledge, where I can find out almost anything. If I want a recipe, I can find out. If I want a certain way of information, geography, history, I can look up very quickly. I can find out what are the best foods. If I have a pain, I can diagnose myself on the internet. I can have knowledge at my fingertips. So in the age of knowledge, scarcity is not of knowledge. We really can't say, I didn't know. We know, because it's an age of knowledge. You can look up, you can find out. Experts are at our fingertips. 20, 30 years ago, that was not the case. But today, experts are at our fingertips. We have no scarcity of knowledge. So scarcity has shifted from knowledge to mindfulness. We are not mindful. Right? And technology then has to shift from just providing us knowledge to providing us mindfulness. So we know what kind of foods to eat for healthy living. Everybody knows that. So we can't say, well, I didn't know that, you know, eating 10 donuts a day was bad for you. I didn't know. Right? We can't say that. How to drive a car so I have no accident? We know. Right? So if you're driving and you're texting, you know that's going to cause some problems. You can't say, I didn't know. You know that. You know how to drive without accidents. You know how to have good relationships. Right? Even as complex as having a good relationship is known. Don't scream at the other person. Don't hit them. Right? So simple things. Be mindful of the other person and their emotions. Exercise, all these things are known. What is lacking is the ability to stay mindful. Right? So you get out of equilibrium. And thermodynamics says, if you get out of equilibrium, here is the price you have to pay. So pay the price. So this knowledge action gap, or NACT, right? So knowledge action NACT. We need to have knowledge action gap close. So laws NACT. Right? So like Moore's law, so Moore's law has driven technology, and next lecture I'll talk about Moore's law, not from the point of view of simply transistors, but the profound implication of something like Moore's law in a person's life. We are all affected by Moore's law. And Moore's law was not a law of gravity, it was not a law of nature. Moore just said, here it is. And everybody participated in it. Right? So Moore's law is a construct. So next lecture, I'll talk about Moore's law and the importance of something like Moore's law. Not just Moore's law is, of course, serving its purpose, but what's the next Moore's law? So here is a next Moore's law, which is driven by the desire for technology to provide mindfulness. So of course, these companies have already provided us food. Right? Walmart can provide us all kind of food. It can cause a lot of damage too. But we have, of course, Kodak is bankrupt. That's okay. You know, they'll come back. What is the new company? So it's up to you and me to provide new technologies that will provide mindfulness, and driven by something like Moore's law. So can technology become like a companion? So if you're driving and a driver's ed teacher is sitting next to you, you almost never get into an accident because they'll constantly guide you. Right? So having technology that is like a guide, a best friend, and for me, like having a yoga teacher with you all the time, telling you, sit like this, adjust, you know. If you're mad, you know, don't be mad. Take this breath. Take two breaths and you're calm. Right? So that's the beauty of yoga. If it's studied well, within two breaths, you're calm. So somebody punches you, you are so mad, you take two breaths, you're back. Can be done. Right? So, but there are technologies that need to be developed that can take you into that mode, remind you, take a deep breath, take this kind of breath. So mindful at work, so you don't get accidents. You know, for factory workers, young factory workers, so easy. You know, just in a snap, a machine will chop your hand off. It can happen. Mindfulness in your relationship. Not shouting, screaming, mindfulness in your consumption. What are the technologies? And these technologies are possible. We have fantastic technologies. These are possible. and I'll talk about some of these technologies in the next lecture. But now we'll stop and we'll do, I see that we have a few more minutes. We'll again do this laughter yoga. Last time it was good, but not that good. Right? So you've got to do better. So let's once again stand up. And This is my last slide. After this, I just have references, some thanks to people, and so on, but this is the last slide. So put all your heart into it. So let's stand and touch our fingers, and the first two breaths we'll take without laughing, just kind of observing ourselves, opening our body. So let's inhale. Feeling really tall, like you can touch the ceiling, and exhale back. And one more. And now get your lungs ready. And let's inhale. All your strength. And one more. And just shake your shoulders, release yourself, and we are done. So I'm going to just, and thanks for coming. So I want to thank some people and some websites we used and people who helped with all this.